Hi, welcome to episode 32. This is our third video about Roman numerals and voice leading, so I'm going to call it three. I kind of named the last two both one because I guess I can't count to two. Let's talk in this lesson about a different progression, and this progression is what we call a 1-5-6-4 progression. And I want to direct you to a couple videos you can watch about this. There's a video, if you just search Axis of Awesome. These are both like kind of musical comedian kind of videos, and I don't really endorse them for their musical value or their comedic value, because like most comedy that has like a music aspect, I don't know, maybe it's just my taste. I usually find that they're both not very funny and not very good music. But it happens that these really, really hammer home the concept. The other one is called Pachelbel Rant. This one guy. The Axis of Awesome is like a band. What they both end up doing is they play a bunch of songs with the same chord progression. Now, Axis of Awesome, it's all this progression. Pachelbel Rant actually starts as a slightly different progression, a longer progression that is a little different, but then it shifts into this progression sneakily without telling you to include more songs. And in both of them, kind of the crux of the humor aspect is like, whoa, all these way different songs from like the pop music of the past 30 years all like use the same chord progression, even though I never noticed they did, and even though they sound so different. And there's a wrong conclusion you can come to. You could come to the conclusion, oh, that just means their derivative and their drivel and like pop music just follows these stale old formulas and therefore can have no value and it's too simple and like it's too uninventive or something like that. And there's very often that's a phase a music theory student will go through where they learn enough to notice how a lot of songs use the same kind of formulas. And then they kind of quit learning and just cut off their mind right there and are like, I'm only gonna like super weird music because I don't wanna like anything I can easily understand. And I don't know, to me that's just dead wrong. Like, if you wanna know how music works, presumably it's because you love music, and if learning how it works is gonna take away your love for it, go study engineering. Or something, I don't know. Go study something you don't wanna like anymore. Music, the more you know about it, for me, the more I like it. And for me, it's exciting, not like sad, to find like commonalities between different kinds of music or different songs, or to notice that song X has the same chord progression as song Y. To me, that's always nice to know. End of my little soapbox. Okay, this chord progression, let's work with it in the key of C major. And we're going to write in what we call keyboard style. Keyboard style, we kind of got into last time. In keyboard style, we usually write just the bass in the left hand. And we write the left hand generally in bass clef, because usually the bass is down there. But the word bass in music theory context just means the lowest note. You got three piccolos, whatever one's playing the lowest note, that's a bass, even if it's up in the stratosphere. In keyboard style, then we usually put three notes in the right hand. And when I talk about keyboard style, I just want to be clear. This keyboard style is like a term we use when we teach music. It doesn't mean that's like the only way to write for a keyboard or the only way to play a keyboard. There's any number of ways to play a keyboard that you can invent with your 10 fingers and 88 keys. But there's just a really common way of writing in keyboard style, or writing for a keyboard, where the left hand just plays one note, and then the right hand plays three notes. And let's do what I would consider kind of bad voice leading, but let's try it. Just to start out with, let's have one of the notes just do exactly what the bass does. You're gonna find out that that's a no-no. You don't wanna have voices that are doing the exact same thing. I shouldn't say the same thing. They're doing the same thing in pitch class. They're both going C, G, A, F. But in actual pitch, this is two octaves higher. So if we play these together, it's like. And then let's give all these chords a third. I was using green for the thirds of chords. And let's give all these chords a fifth. And last episode, I was talking about what I kept calling kind of chunky voice leading. And this is definitely a very chunky way to voice lead these four chords. These four chords being C, G, A minor, and F, which in the key of C play the role of 1, 5, 6, and 4. And if we do it just like this, it's going to sound like this. Right? Even with that chunky voice leading, it probably sounds kind of nice and kind of familiar. But I don't like that chunky voice leading. For one thing, we talked about we don't like just everything moving as one big blob. For another thing, like I said, especially in classical music, we don't like hearing intervals of a fifth move in tandem like this. Right? It doesn't sound that bad. If we were 200 years ago, it would sound tremendously bad. But let's smooth it out. Let's smooth it out, and let's do it like this. Let's start with the same voicing, and we're always going to keep the same bass line. But I want to take another stab at this. Smooth out this voice leading. So let's start with the C, E, and G, just like I did. Although technically, let's be totally correct. I'm playing them down here now. When you work on music, I hope you do it with a pencil so you don't have this kind of stuff. I just like how the colored ink looks on these videos. So here's this first chord. Now, let's do the first rule of voice leading. Move as little as possible. And what I should say, really, is move each voice. And what I should do, really, is put an asterisk by voice and say, except the bass. As I mentioned last episode, and as I will continue to mention, the bass line gets to do kind of whatever it wants. Okay, wait, that's an exaggeration. The bass line just doesn't have the same... We don't require a bass line to act smooth. A bass line can be melodic if it wants, but it can also just... totally be like the foundations of the chords. And a lot of times in pop music, it'll be the foundation of the chords. And a lot of times in classical music, it'll be the foundation of the chords. Almost all the time in jazz music, it's melodic. You know, a walking bass you may have heard of. Anyhow, we think of these voices, we think of these other notes as voices. And when we're not writing in keyboard style, we're writing in what we call SATB style. And maybe you know that that's soprano, alto, and tenor, and B is the bass. So kind of in keyboard style, what we're doing is we're putting the soprano, alto, and tenor all squished together so that you can all fit them into your five fingers of your right hand. And so even if these aren't really registrally in a tenor, alto, or soprano range, though these ones are all reasonably within that range, we like to call them that. So I'm going to call this voice that starts on C the tenor voice, and I'm going to call this voice that starts on E the alto voice, and the voice that starts on G the soprano voice, and I'm going to move them all the least distance possible to get to the notes that are in my G chord. So a lot of times when you're first starting with this stuff, a good idea is to kind of write down the notes you have to pick from. So here we need a G, a B, and a D. And so first see if any of them are already there, because the least distance you can move is no distance at all. I can tell you, though, there's none. There are no common... Oh, wait. Oh, my gosh. There is one. It's the G, right? Here's the G. It can stay there, and now it's the root. So that soprano went from singing a G, which was the fifth of the C chord, to a G, which is the fifth, which is the root of a G chord. And then the E, the closest note it can get to, is the D. A D is the fifth of the G chord. And then the C, the closest note it can come down to, is the B. So this is a good, smooth way to get from the C chord to the G chord. So that soprano just went, and the alto went, and the tenor went, and all together. Are you starting to get why it's called voice leading? We call it voice leading because it's how we lead each voice from chord to chord. Now, our next chord, this is where I thought I was last time. A, C, and E are what are in an A minor chord. None of those are going to be common. So, we have a couple choices. One thing we could do is literally move every single one of these up a step. But remember, I said we don't really like when things do the same thing, and that would require our G and our G to both go up and become an A and an A. And we don't like to have two voices do the same thing. So let's move down. This G, let's have it move down to an E. An E is actually going to be the fifth of our A minor chord. And then this D can go to a C pretty easily. A C is the third of our A minor chord. And this B can go down to the root of our A minor chord, A. So far now we're going to have this. And then we'll do the same thing with our F. Our F chord has an F, an A, and a C in it. That's an F, I swear. So look, the A and the C are already there. And the E can go just one step up and get to the F. And then the A is the third of the chord. And the C is the fifth of the chord. So we went like this. Oh, what did we do? We went like this. Right? So let's compare and contrast. Here's the first chunkier version. Oh, sorry. And here's our much smoother version. Try another. Let's do our C chord starting with a different voicing. Let's have its root be up here. And then let's have its fifth be here and its third be here. So that we're starting like with this voicing. Now we definitely want to keep the G because there's a G in a G chord and the least distance you can move is none at all. And then a nice thing is this E can go down to the G's fifth. And the C can go down to the G's third. And now we have this. And on this one, let's try and do something a little more clever. There's a couple different ways we could go with this A chord, but I kind of want to put the A here. And I'll show you why in a second. So then we can move its fifth here, which is a third away from there. And its third can be down here, and we have this so far. And then this A can stick around and be the third of our F chord. Thirds have been writing in here. The C can stick around and be the fifth of our F chord. And all that has to move is this E can go up to F. And that gives us this. Oh, whoops, sorry, I played that wrong. Pretty nice, right? So, there are a couple reasons this chord I chose, but one is I like this, like, little melody. 3-C-B-A-A, I don't know. It's pretty. Sometimes a good reason to pick a voicing is to bring out a nice melody in the top voice. So, running out of time, these are all ways to play 1-5-6-4, and they sound pretty dramatically different. The importance of voicing. Learn it, know it, it's a 1, a 5, a 6, a 4. Goodbye.